Muito bom dia. Em primeiro lugar, gostaria de agradecer à professora Margarida Bastos por ter aceitado o convite para estar aqui hoje, que é com muito prazer que as recebemos nas nossas PAthlestras. A professora Margarida Bastos é licenciada em Química pela Faculdade de Ciências da Universidade do Porto, doutorada em Termoquímica pela Universidade de Lund, na Suécia, e desde 2011 que tem o título de agregado pela Universidade do Porto. A professora publicou mais de 60 artigos em revistas especializadas e as suas áreas principais, eu diria que são a química de coloides, química física, biofísica e bioquímica. Como temas mais específicos, gostaria de salientar estudos em proteínas, DNA, polissacáridos, surfactantes e iónicos líquidos também. A professora trabalha também muito em propriedades termodinâmicas, tais como entalpias de solução, solubilidades, calorimetria. Mas talvez o tópico principal sejam os péptidos sobre os quais a professora irá falar aqui hoje. Portanto, sem mais demoras, professora, seja muito bem-vinda.
Good morning. I was told I should speak English because some people in the audience are not Portuguese, so all my slides are in English and I English. And I start obviously to thank Pedro and the Universidade de Aveiro for this kind invitation, and it's my pleasure to be with you today and share part of my research. As Pedro said, recently my main area of research has been antimicrobial peptides and their interactions with membranes. So what I will show you today are some examples of systems that we have been studying and trying to show you our approach, which has been a biophysical approach because that's my area, but always exploring the bridge to their pathogen effects. So let's start with saying that classical antibiotics, they have, we can say, basically three main ways of working, so that can target the bacterial walls like penicillins or cephalosporins, or interfere with essential bacterial enzymes as duquesnolones and sulfonamides, or target protein synthesis as aminoglycosides, macrolides, and tetracyclines. The problem is that they are highly specific, and during the years since their discovery, their indiscriminate use in human health, agriculture, and meat production led to a huge increase, which nowadays is really a big health problem of resistance against conventional antibiotics. And so this urges the need for a new paradigm, not only new antibiotics, and as you probably know, for many years that really new antibiotics did not appear in the market, only second and third generation of old ones. And so the people felt that what we need now is a new paradigm, so that we can try to stop sort of the resistance. And so new fighting strategies against pathogens. As it was recognized by the World Health Organization, we have to combat the resistance now, because if there is no action today, there will be no cure tomorrow. And so we have been working along these lines and taking I was going to say a new, and it's not that new any longer because it has been research, a lot of research in this area for at least more than 10 years, but they are called the antimicrobial peptides. They are considered a new potential alternative to fight infectious disease. They are present in almost all living organisms, as part, including humans, as part of our immune systems. And they have been discovered from different sources with varying lengths and properties. But basically, they have constitutive or inducible formation. They are small, typically less than 50 amino acids, and characterized by a high content of cationic amino acids. So they have an overall positive charge, but they also have hydrophobic amino acids, so they form amphipathic structures. Those are the structures that are active. They have wide activity against gram-positive, gram-negative fungi, protozoa, viruses, even cancer cells. That area has been more and more research on the use of peptides against cancers. What is their main difference as compared to old antibiotics is that they target the membrane and not the specific point like the ones I mentioned. If we take a look here in a kind of a draft of gram-positive and gram-negative membranes, what I wanted to mainly point for you is that their outside is negatively charged. And that is a very important point because that will be what make these antimicrobial peptides specific. So why are they specific? Because the membranes, the pathogen membranes, have more negative as well as the cancer membranes than our membranes. They have no sterols in the bacteria, very little phosphatidylcholine or sphingomyelin, and they have a significant percentage of phosphatidylglycerol, phosphatidyl ethanolamine, cardiolipin, and phosphatidylserine. So this is svitrionic, considered svitrionic, but is slightly negatively charged, and these are negatively charged. And the peptides are cationic. So the initial, at least the initial responsible for the interaction is electrostatics. And the specificity is based on charge. So let's see a little bit how they work. What is the state of the art? They can have a mechanism of direct killing by membrane disruption. Then after membrane disruption, they can also have internal targets and the cell metabolism. There is also the possibility of immune modulation, which has been very much explored, but I will not speak about that because that's not what I deal with in my model work. How do they act? I will now try to explain in cartoons the action, the mode of action of these peptides. So there is an initial attraction to the membrane because of electrostatics as well as hydrogen bonding. Then, since they also have, they are amphipathic structures, as I told you, so usually they coil into alpha helix, although some are also beta structures, but alpha helix is more common, and they are amphipathic, which means that part of the alpha helix is hydrophobic and the other is charged, positively charged. And the positively charged part attracts to the membrane and the hydrophobic helps to the introduction in the membrane. Then they start to accumulate at the surface, and usually there is a threshold concentration after which there is either a conformational transition or a self-association and multimerization that leads to the formation of pores that have been mainly described as toroidal or viral step. These two types of pores in the membranes. In many cases, they translocate to the inside, they accumulate, and they can have, and many cases are already reported where they do have intercellular components where they act specifically, but that's not a requirement. The action of most of them is just the action at the membrane level. So these are the representation of what I was saying in cartoons. So here you have one of the pores that has been reported, the barrel stave, not common, just one peptide to my knowledge has been reported to have this one. This part is much more common. So this is the accumulation you have, you see it in the red and blue because of this amphipathic character. They go to the surface of the membrane and then they evolve either to the formation of pores or even to, and this is called the carpet mechanism because they accumulate as a kind of a carpet on the surface. And then they can also micellize the membrane like a detergent. And recently it has been recognized that cubic structures are very important in these mechanisms of action. They can also totally destroy the membrane by peptide intercalation in between, and I will show you examples of this. And they form a stack or an aggregation with total membrane destruction. These are proposed mechanisms. So what have been my approach has been to work in connection with microbiologists to try to bridge model membrane results with the action against pathogens, which is actually the title of my talk today. So I tried to start with peptides of recognized peptide action so that I could test them by biophysical techniques in model membranes of different composition. By model membranes, I mean liposomes that I build in the lab, that I prepare. And the advantage is that they are the preparation allows me to be quite flexible in the composition of the membranes. And then I use different biophysical techniques like differential scanning calorimetry, isothermal titration calorimetry, circular dichroism, time-resolved fluorescent spectroscopy, X-ray diffraction, microscopy. More recently, I started also to use FTAR with ATR, as well as in collaboration, molecular dynamic simulation. And then I tried to use the modern membrane results to understand the mechanism's action, test new microbial approach, and then try to come to new and more potent antimicrobial peptides. So basically, this is the approach taken in the results that I will show you. As model membranes, as I said, I use liposomes. They are a very simplified model of the biological membranes. What is the interest of using these simplified models is that we can control the different aspects that are important in the interaction. We can change the charge, we can change the size, we can change the composition, we can introduce cholesterol, not introduce, so we can do a wide variation, but keeping control of what we are changing. So that's very important to do then a study of the main effects that are important in this type of interactions. So different cell types can be mimicked by varying the phospholipid composition of the liposomes. So to mimic the eukaryotic membranes, I use membranes composed basically of a phosphatidylcholine. And in my studies, I've been using, and as I will show you, good results, only phosphatidylcholine membranes without cholesterol, although we know that this is not a good or a perfect, let's say, model, but it works quite well, as you will see. And when I want to model fungi, I use mixtures of PC and PG lipids. To model prokaryotic membranes, I have used PCPG as well as PE or PEPG. So I will try to show you results briefly from two case studies, one involving lactoferrin peptides and the other peptides that are hybrid between secretin A and melitin. So let's start with the lactoferrin peptides. This work was made as a collaboration with Professor Jan Bolscher from Amsterdam, the Netherlands, and they were working for many years with lactoferrin and their extracted peptides. And in particular, they work with this peptide from this part of the lactoferrin, which is called lactoferrin 17 to 30, and that corresponds to the number of amino acids from the original protein. And then they also found that the part which form a helix here in the lactoferrin, which encompasses the amino acids between 265 and 284, was also potentially a good antimicrobial peptide. Due to this position in the molecule, in the lactoferrin, which by the way is by itself slightly antimicrobial, they thought that maybe this position between these two helices was important, and so they created three peptides. This one, which is called lactoferrin, I will call from now on LFCin 1730. This one, lactoferampin, they call it alfampin 265284, and then a construct, which they call chimera, where they made a very special binding between these two peptides to try to maintain this. So the second peptide was bound to a side chain of an extra lysine to try to keep this structure. So here we have the peptides, their MD structure, and the chimera. Okay, you can see that this one has a positive charge of plus 4, plus 6 for this one, and this is a huge charge, plus 12. Okay, this is their previous work. They are not biophysicists, so they work with the action against real pathogens, and since they belong to a dentistry department, and so they previously had tested these peptides before I started to work with them, and they found that you can see here the killing capacity of the lactoferrin itself, the native lactoferrin, and then you have here the LFCin, the alfampin, and the chimera. And you see that obviously the chimera is more potent than the others. Is the only one which action does not change significantly with the change in ionic strength. And finally, they also determined the so-called LC50, so the concentration of pathogens that are dead after 50, the LFC50, and so you can see here the lowest the value, the better. So against the candida, we can see that this 1730 is the less active, being this the most active, but this is already quite significantly active, okay? The bad part of the lactoferrin, which was extremely active, is that they also tested that that peptide was hemolytic, significantly hemolytic, while the other ones were almost not hemolytic, okay? So L-chimera was the only one that was significantly toxic. So I started the model membrane to try to understand how they work. I used, for this one, since it was mainly against fungus, I used DMPC to test for toxicity, and this mixture and the pure negatively charged to test for the action against the pathogen. As a start, I always use DSC because I have been trying to convince people that DSC is the fantastic technique to a first approach to the activity of these peptides, because we can see it's very easy to use, and from determine the enthalpy of interaction, the TM, and eventual changes in profile of the curve, which describes the transition between two lipid phases, which is the gel phases, where the lipids are more organized and rigid, to the fluid phase, where the chains are more mobile. And that transition is very well seen in DSC, and so we can use it to see, when we add the peptides, how this is changing. And let's see here. So what we have is the results in horizontal for DMPC for the three peptides, for the purely negatively charged DMPG, and for the mixture, which is the situation more close to the real pathogens. So what can we conclude from here? We can see that these two really do not, I mean, the curves, I should say that we have the percentage here on the right, and this is the percentage of peptide that is added to the model membrane. And it, when it increases all the way up to 3%, there is no effect from either of these two peptides in the PC membranes, whereas for the chimera, we have a significant effect. So this goes very well with the toxicity that was found when they were testing it against the real fungus, against Candida, where this was the only one that was significantly toxic. Then we see that they all interact with both purely negatively charged membranes, as well as with the partly 3-to-1 negatively charged membranes, and they are not all the same. I cannot describe you into detail all how to interpret all these curves. We will see something because we have no time, and I wanted to give you an overall picture of this study. So, but basically we can see that all peptides interact strongly with negatively charged membranes, being obviously the strongest, the chimera peptide, which is the one with highest charge, then followed by L-thampin and finally L-fcin. And as I said, only chimera interacts with the liposomes formed the only PC, so we found an excellent agreement between our DSC results and the antimicrobial activity and hemolytic tests. So we were happy, we could proceed, let's move on. What did we do then? So then we decided to use other techniques to try to unravel the mechanism of action. So we did study the peptide structure and characterize both in solution and in the presence of membranes by circular decruism. We characterized the partition to membranes by time resolved fluorescence spectroscopy and isothermal titration calorimetry. We also, and this is in gray because I will not show you, but during the years we also dealt with the energetics of the interaction and finding critical ratios for interaction, this kind of threshold that I told you before by ITC. By using DLS and in particular zeta potential, we determine the effective charges of the peptides because, and just a detail, what I showed you as plus 4, plus 7, plus 12 is what I call the nominal charge, which means the counting of the number of positive charge, positive amino acids that I have in the peptide. But then, as I also told you, they, and as you will see now in the CD results, They are usually coiled in solution and they are active at the membrane when they coil into an alpha structure or a beta structure. And what happens is that when that coiling takes place, not all the charges will be available to interact effectively with the membrane because they will be distributed around the helix. And so that's the difference between nominal charge and effective charge. The effective charge is the charge that the membrane feels, okay? And then we use the X-ray diffraction to characterize the structure of peptide model membranes interactions. So by CD, let me show you briefly some results. So this is what I call usually the model peptide. This is an amazing, well-behaved peptide. You can see here, those of you that have done CD or know a bit on how these things are characterized. So this is the typical CD curve of a random coil. That's where they are, how they are in buffer when you don't have membranes. And then in the presence of membranes, you can see that in blue, which maybe you don't see very well, but it is here, is in the presence of the MPC. So this confirms that this DSC results, that there is almost no interactions because the curves are basically superimposed. But when we have either PCPG or PG, we have a very nice, this is typical for a helix, with a minimum of, at 208 and 222. So they form an alpha helix. So curiously, the LFCN had a strange behavior. We will elaborate on this later on because in the presence of purely negative membranes, it formed just a beta turn. In the presence of the mixture of PCPG, it formed the helix. And in buffer, it was not as pure random coil as the LFPIN 265284. Okay, so this is a little bit different. Let's now look at the chimera. The chimera is already in buffer, a mixture of structures, because it seems probably, for those of you who did not do CD, that seems similar to this, and it is similar, but if you see the minima is more to the right, so is not as unstructured as this one. There is already a mixture of structures, but in the presence of PCPG, we have a very good helix. In the presence of PG, we also have a helix, although with not so strong signal, but in the presence of the MPC, we have clearly a mixture of structures. And again, that goes very well along with the strong interaction that we observe by DSC of this peptide with the model membranes for erythrocytes, so the sphytrionic membranes, okay? So then we wanted to characterize numerically the partition of the peptides to the membrane. And for that purpose, the fluorescence spectroscopy is a very good technique because these peptides that I was using here, all of them have one tryptophan. And so having one tryptophan, we can follow the partition from the aqueous environment to the membrane by fluorescence. Why did I use time resolved? And I did that in Lisbon in the lab of Professor Manuel Prieto, which is our Portuguese biophysicist specialist and worldwide known in this technique in fluorescence spectroscopy. And they have a time-resolved fluorescence spectroscopy very well developed with some homemade instruments and so on. Why do we need time-resolved? In many cases we do because, having I told you that interaction is basically electrostatic, you can imagine that they attract each other, and in many cases they precipitate. And that prevents us in many cases to study by conventional spectroscopy because the aggregates sediment and we don't see anything. Time resolved is not affected by the precipitation, and so we use this to get very good results for this and other peptides. And you can see here what is the not binding but partition constant, because that's what we are talking. We are talking of the partition of the peptides between the aqueous media and what we can consider another media, which is the membranes that are suspended in the aqueous media. So we talk about partition and not about binding K. And the partition, you can see here for the chimera, 4.5, 10 to 5. L-lysine 7 10 to the 5, L-thampine 1.7 10 to the 5. So, in fact, the surprising value here is this peptide, because, as you saw previously, in terms of CD, it was not that well characterized, and in terms of DSE, it did not seem very strong. But yet, by fluorescence spectroscopy, in terms of partition to the membrane, it is a very strong partition. I have to point out to the fact that this has a much higher charge than this one, and that, as we will see, will be the reason for the higher partition, although in terms of effect, then it is not the same thing, and I will point out that to you in the end. So, since we were aiming a structure to unravel the mechanism, we decided also to do X-ray. So what can we get from X-ray? SAX stands for small angle X-ray diffraction. We can do that with membranes and follow the transition from gel to, this is the main transition, from gel to fluid lamellar, because we will have peaks that show that we have a lamellar structure. We can find from the SAX results the distance between, so the separation between the layers when we have multi-layers, because we need to work with multi-layers in SAX, otherwise we don't have a signal. We need to have a repetition. And so we can determine transition temperature by layer spacing, and more importantly, what are the phases present. This is just the lamellar phase, but we can also identify if they are present, hexagonal, cubic, and so on. And this is an example of an hexagonal inverted phase, or one of the cubic phases that we came upon, and that can give us a hint about the mechanism of action. Okay, let's see what we found for these peptides. So let's start with the L-lysine that we have seen. It was not very potent, but yet it had a very high partition to the membrane. When we did the study by DSE, here we have curves of going up in temperature, going down in temperature. So from the gel to the fluid, from the fluid back to the gel. When we cool, we see that whereas initially we only had one lamellar phase, after cooling we have two. Okay, so what we think, and I hope you saw, and I will tell you again, and I will show the movie again. First, let's go back. First, we have our membranes with the negatively charged lipids, which are the red ones, distributed in the membrane. And what this peptide is doing is that it is inducing a segregation. And then we have two gel phases, one more rich in PG and the other more rich in PC with some PG. So this peptide is not destroying the membrane, but just causing a segregation. And remind that, because it will be important later. Let's go to the other peptide, the L-thampine 264285. And this one, we saw that it was a completely different behavior. And in fact, we could find out that this formed a micellar cubic phase. And this was really the first time that the cubic phase was reported in the antimicrobial area. We published that in 2011 in Biophysical Journal in a letter, because it was, we found a very important finding. And since then, it has been widely recognized that cubic phases are very important in the mechanism of action of antimicrobial peptides. As regarding the chimera, then we have a complicated mixture of two, not one, but two bicontinuous cubic phases. So when we add the peptide to the membrane, we have not one, but two cubic phases, but not micellar cubic phase, what we call bicontinuous cubic phases. So the membrane is totally destroyed. Okay, so now let's see how we compare our results from other membranes with the results from microbiology. So by model membranes, we observed that L-lysine only induced a lipid segregation, and Bolscher previously, many years before, with some, with actually Candida, could observe that this peptide only formed segregation. This is a TEM result, segregation in these Candida membranes. With L-lysine, as I just showed you, we saw a cubic micellar phase, so a detergent-like action, and they observed exactly that vesicles could be seen as extracted from the membrane of Candida by this peptide. finally, by saxing with chimera, we found the formation of two bicontinuous cubic faces, and they found a total disruption that is compatible with this formation of cubic faces. So this means that overall, we were very happy with the model membrane studies. DSC provided the first and fast characterization of the interaction, where we can determine if it exists and what is the level of perturbation. CD gave us information on the secondary structures changes. Lorentz spectroscopy provided the actual numbers of partition to the membrane, and ITC, a very complete mapping of the binding process. I did not show, but it did, and that is published, providing the delta H and Kp. And finally, sex showed the structure of the peptide lipid, showing that the structure depends on lipid and on PL ratios. So that allowed us to propose a mode of action and correlated very well with the Candida albicans results. So we were really happy with this. So then, a word of caution, that's about what I was telling you before. A high Kp as we have for LFCN does not mean that we have a peptide that is more membrane active, because in fact by DSC we saw that it was not significantly membrane active. So this seemed contradictory until it was observed that in fact this peptide is very active because it has internal targets. And it has been observed by other people, and it's proved nowadays that this peptide main action is not on the membrane, so it's not membranolytic, so it has internal targets. So everything fits and our results were correct. So then we followed some other projects that I will briefly mention to you. We followed, tested the antimicrobial activity of lactoferrin peptides against Mycobacterium avium in collaboration with the Professor Salome Gomes from IBMC. Then we moved on to testing the amino acids, because this is a long story, but we observed that the D were much better than the L, because they are not digested quickly by proteins, and that was published, the activity of arginine and the amino acid containing molecules in Mycobacterium. Then we also, knowing that this peptide induces membrane segregation, we also tried to test its synergism with conventional antibiotics. So if this peptide only segregates the membrane to be able to enter, could it help other antibiotics to enter? And so this was done also in collaboration with Salome and the PhD student I had. And the ethambutol is a classical antibiotic used against tuberculosis. And we observed that in fact, there was a synergistic action. And our explanation is that the peptide helps to open the membrane to the conventional antibiotics, and so they act better in the presence of the peptide. So the peptide is not destructing the membrane, is a facilitator to the entrance of another peptide. Moving on to the second case I would like to present you today. It's a case with a hybrid peptide from melitin and secropin. Melitin and secropin are two natural antimicrobial peptides, one from mold and the other from bee. And the thing is that melitin is too strong and this is too mild. And so the group of David Andreu in Barcelona thought for many years, and already back when he was in the United States with Merrifield, that we could do hybrids between the two peptides, taking some amino acids from one and some amino acids from the others. And they did a lot of them. And we worked for several years with two and some modified versions of them, but I will show you here results only for one of them, which was called by David the CA17, because it had the first seven amino acids from secropin and amino acids from 229 from melitin. Okay, so David Andreu in Barcelona, together with Luis Rivas in Madrid, had proven that this peptide had good antimicrobial activity against a number against a wide range of pathogens. And so we did our usual biophysics works using these techniques. And so here you have the results for the DSC, first approach, as I told you, that I always use. And you see that in the presence of the MPC, which if you remember, I use as a toxicity test, let's call it like that, these peptides are very different from the previous non-active. because they interact really with this, particularly the big one, they interact with the svitrionic membranes. They interact strongly with the MPG, and they also interact with the CPG. I also determined the structure by CD, and it's a very well-behaved helix that we have here with the, this is in buffer, a minimum before 200, and in the presence of membranes, in this case POPE, POPG, we have the typical minimum at 208 and 222, so we have a helix. Okay, so then moving on, the first results were with PCPG, then we also did with PEPG. PEPG is a more a system that is more close to the actual biological systems, a little bit more difficult to work with, but in any case, we could see that, in fact, the peptides are changing. So this is the pure lipid system, then in the presence of various increasing amounts of peptides. So it is definitely changing, as you will see here. We did study also by ITC. I cannot discuss here with you the details, but I will give you the reference of the paper. So, but this is just titrating the peptide into POPE, POPG at 30 degrees, which means that the lipids are in the gel phase, and we can see that there is a strong interaction. We use the partition model, and which, as I told you, that's what we should use. So we could, by this, treating this curve with the partition model, this ITC curve, we could determine the partition constant to the membrane, 3×10⁵, the enthalpy of interaction, and the effective charge. The nominal charge is +6, and here the effective charge is 4.7. The effective charge, as I told you before, is always lower than the nominal charge. Then, this we did also titrations at other temperatures, so at 5 degrees, where the lipids are in the gel phase. And there you see that the behavior is completely different. We have a decrease, then we have a, what is the word? We have a constant value of the heat here, and then it starts to go up. We also did at 17, where we have a mixture between gel and lipid phase. And so the interpretation of this was quite difficult. I have no time to go through with you in the, but it is in the paper that I will give you the reference. And then PEPG membranes, we go to sacs, and the PEPG forms oligolamellar vesicles with we call unbound and uncorrelated bilayers. So due to the charge, they don't form multilayers, but oligolamellar means with a couple of bilayers. We used also confocal microscopy and optical microscopy to see the effect with the peptides. And so let's start with the SACS results. I apologize because this is covering, but it doesn't matter. It's just to say that when we do it in the fluid phase, what can we see? This is the pure lipids, so not well defined because we don't have multilayers. We have oligolamellar vesicles. But what happens when we add the peptides? When we add the peptides, we start to have a clear lamellar structure. That's the basic I can tell you from here. Because when we have these peaks that repeat, it means we have, and when the peaks are very narrow, we mean we have a, that means we have a lot of layers. Here we have broad peaks, meaning that we have 2 to 3 layers, not well defined. But when we add the peptides, we have very sharp peaks. That means an increase in the number of layers. Okay? By confocal microscopy and optical microscopy, we could see that as opposed to the previous, where we saw the both techniques, optical and confocal, this is the red because we had the lipids with Texas red fluorescence marker. And you saw, you see the vesicles, but when we add the peptides, everything is completely destroyed. Okay. So the peptide induces a high membrane condensation with the formation of a multilamellar structure, where, as we will see, we propose that the peptide is intercalated. By using polarized light microscopy, which you also used, we can see these structures that, for those of you who have used this technique, the fact that we find B refringence indicates that we have, and the presence of this called Maltese cross-like patterns means that we have an onion-like structure. So this means we have a superimposition of many layers. And so we could conclude that the peptide interacts strongly with this model membrane, which is a membrane for the bacterial model membrane, and acts by inducing the formation of multilamellar onion-like structures where the peptide is intercalated. But further to that, we could show by analyzing in details the forms that we observe by X-ray that in fact it forms, that our proposal, and it has been also found by others in this area, forms two types of membranes. You can see here it segregates the negatively charged lipids with the peptide here in between, and then the svitrionic lipids are forming another bilayer. So it is kind of extracting the negatively charged too close to the peptide, because the peptide is positively charged. And so we have, and this was observed because we had a double distance as compared to the original one. So this was published in Langmuir. So we showed that when the peptide is added to liposomes, we have a bilayer stacking with two differences. At low temperature, we have the L-gamma phase, and at high temperature, we have the L-alpha phase. So this was a very interesting study where it took us many years to unravel these results. And I would like to share with you, because for me, this was a very interesting experience, because there was a moment where we almost thought, I have to tell you that most people working in this area, they do SACS only in the fluid phase, because it's true that is the relevant biological phase, because in our body the chains are in the fluid phase. I always do like to do also the gel phase to see the transitions, but I mean, what was puzzling, what was killing us for many years was the results in the gel phase. And it was really tempting to forget these results because they were not biologically relevant and they were very difficult to encompass. But I'm very happy that although it took us more than 2 years, we did not give up to try to understand, and we were able finally to publish this paper where we can give a rationale for the very unusual results that we find at gel phase and fluid phase, and everything makes sense. So it was good not to give up, because if we think long enough, we can understand things. So nowadays, moving on to new systems and new challenges, just to leave you here the note, what I'm dealing nowadays is in collaboration with Juan Granger from Santiago de Compostela. He worked with Gadiri in the United States, and already back in 93, they published they work with peptides that are cyclic peptides that can form nanotubes in a variety of conditions, including in the presence of membranes. And so we are dealing now with the several generations of these peptides that one is synthesizing. And together with Barbara, my present PhD student, we are doing the biophysical studies. So we are using DSE as usually, ITC and ATR, FTR, and also doing dispersion studies. I mean, just optical dispersion to see the aggregation, and doing fluorescence spectroscopy to see the partition to the membranes. I mean, and we also did SACS, indeed. I mean, our usual plethora of techniques. But in this case, we are also in collaboration with Rebecca Fandinho. She was a researcher here with the FCT project for 3 years. Now she's back in Santiago, but we continue to collaborate, and she's the responsible for the molecular dynamic simulation studies that are also done by a postdoc that we have now here with us, which is Antonio. So the acknowledgements, I have to thank for all this work Salome for the microbiology studies of Mycobacterium avium from IBMC, Paulo Gomes from our department who synthesized part of the CAM family peptides, David Andreu, which synthesized and was the starter of these peptides, Bolscher and Kamram Nazmi, who is the technician that synthesized the peptide in ACTA in the Netherlands, Manuel Priet and Ana Coutinho at Técnico, where we go to do the time resolved fluorescence spectroscopy. For the SACS, I collaborate with Daniela Gurikova from Bratislava, Bruno Silva, who is now at INL, and Sergio Funari at DESI, Germany, where we did the experiments that I reported here. And now we are doing it in Barcelona in present days. Rebecca for the MD studies, and these were students and postdocs that collaborated in the results that I show you today. And so I would end just with a quote that I like very much, which is that science is facts, and just as houses are made of stone, so is science made of facts. But you have to remember that a pile of stones is not a house, as well as a collection of facts is not necessarily science. And I thank you for your attention. And I left 10 minutes so that you could ask questions if you so wish.
So, Professor, thank you very much for your very interesting talk. And the session is now open for questions. Anyone?
Pedro.
Oh,
I have to start. Margarida, bom dia.
Bom dia.
Many, many thanks for this wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
I'm sorry I was not present at the very beginning. I just start when you turn on your micro, so I think I didn't miss much.
Just one time.
It was really a great presentation because it showed how something that seems apparently unrelated to many of the things that we are doing is actually related to everything that we are doing. And I'm not just talking about the people in my group that are working with biopharmaceuticals, for whom what you have been presenting is almost immediate, the relationship. Although they are doing different approaches, but the understanding of the mechanisms of how an antimicrobial compound works is absolutely important to anyone that is working in this field. But it's related to other things as well, and I was particularly concerned with the relation of what you have been presenting to the extraction of biocompounds from biomass. And it may not be apparent to many of the students here, but actually what you have been showing is the explanation of why surfactants are good at extracting things from biomolecules. We knew that they disrupt membranes, what you have been showing is that they can act in many different ways. If we look at your peptides as a sort of surfactant, because they are, the mechanisms are very different. You have a variety of mechanisms, and that's what we have to learn and to try to understand better for the things that we do, how these things work. And although I'm not asking them to spend the many years that you did to try to pinpoint the actual mechanism of the action of each surfactant in each membrane, in each microorganism that we are working, because that would be unfeasible. I would really like to understand from you whether there is a simple way of looking into the disruption of the cells without trying to understand the entire mechanism. Mm-hmm. And obviously your electronic microscopy images were wonderful. Where have you been doing that?
The in IBMC in I3, E3S, but the time it was IBMC. So they have TEM, and they have confocal, very good confocal microscopy.
And do you think the confocal is a good and easy technique to see how the membranes on the cells are affected by the presence of these compounds?
Yeah, I would say that if you want, depends on the aim. I mean, if you want, in this case, what we were doing was to mark the lipids with this Texas red so that we can see it and confocal, otherwise we would not see it. They use it very much to larger organisms like microorganisms and so on, and that is much better because you see better. And so you can see the disruption, and you can see, let's say, the change in structure. I think I did not show you, but I can show you, for example, other images that we got there for mycobacteria, for example. Let me, may I share the screen in a minute? Is that okay?
Yes, of course.
Okay. Sure. So, because let me see, I might have here images. I wanted to show you another. Now, this is M. No. Just 1 second, and I might be able to show you here very briefly just other images that were really nice. Plain by microscopy. So maybe even.
Way you're showing, it's still the old PowerPoint because you're still, you chose a window instead of a desktop.
You shouldn't share and share, yeah.
Yeah, and now I open the share again. And so even here. Can you see now this?
Yes.
Okay, because here you have here TEM and SEM of this. That's what I was going to say. I'm not going to show so many things because we don't have time. But I mean, confocal microscopy is very good to see the overall change if you can mark it, okay? Then what we did also is what you see here above is SEM. SEM is very nice to see changes in morphology. For example, here you have the intact mycobacteria and here after the addition of peptides. You don't see details, but you see changes. Then if you want to see details, you have to go to TEM, okay? I don't know if I answer your
question. Yes, certainly. And so
I think
we
that,
should try to yes. use these techniques yes. to at least have some idea of what is going on at the cell level.
And I have to tell you that in IBMC, they are very good on this. Paula Sampaio is extremely good, and confocal microscopes, they have excellent. And they have people that they have a dedicated, Paula is responsible for the unit. They have another responsible person for the TEM, and they are used to do it with, for example, for me, TEM with the liposomes, I cannot do it. It's too small. But if you use microorganisms, you can do it, and it is very enlightening in terms of what happens. The same I do here in the Center of Materials of Oporto. So I think it is, I am, as you well know, a physical chemist, and usually I'd say I'm a calorimetrist, I like calorimetry, but more and more over the years, microscopy appears to me as a wonderful technique because we see things, we see.
Yeah. Margarida, many, many thanks for your time and this very enlightening presentation.
Thank you, João. It was a pleasure. More questions?
I have one question.
Sure. Can you please talk a bit louder?
Yes, I will try.
Okay.
So, did you use model membranes and then you see the interactions with the peptides in model membranes?
Yes.
But how these mimic the more complex membranes that we have, because mm-hmm. For example, in the membranes, we have also proteins mm-hmm. that are in membranes. Mm-hmm. How do you believe that the peptides in membranes with proteins mm-hmm. can change or not this type of interaction? So, because you are using, I understand that you use a model membrane that is easier to see how these interact with phospholipids. Yeah. That I'm curious about how it will work for more complex with proteins and with more complex structures.
Sure. Yeah, you are indeed right. But that's what I tried, not so successfully, I can see today, to show that, in fact, we see a parallel between our very results in very simple model membranes and actual pathogens, because I show you the parallel of the results of the lactoferrin studies between our results with model membranes and the results with the candida albicans. And the things fit, okay? So I know, and I have to tell you that the first time I went to Amsterdam and present the results, I faced people that were much more aggressive than you and said, do you really think that is good for anything? I mean, we think that is worth nothing because it's not complex as our cells or our pathogens are. I think it is worse. And what I used to say is the following. I'd never pretend at all that my model is very close to the systems, to the actual biological systems. What I say all the time is that what I do with this very simple model is to capture some facts that are important for what I'm studying. In, for example, in this case of antimicrobial peptides, that we all know now that the charge is a very important fact, and that's what makes specificity. Okay, because the antimicrobial peptides are positively charged, and the, both the fungus and the cancer and the pathogens, the bacteria, are more, much more negatively charged. So it has to be electrostatic. So what I'm doing is not really pretending to mimic in detail the membranes, is to try to take the factors that are important so that I can do exactly a factor analysis. How important is the charge? How important is the cholesterol? How important is the type of lipid? How important is the length of the chain? It's because that's the approach that can be used in a biophysics simple study. And that's very enlightening. We don't I strongly believe, and I try to pass this over all my career, I am a believer in collaboration. I don't think that nowadays, with the present state of knowledge, you can do all by yourself, because there is no way, right? Because the specialization is so strong, so I don't even try, because I think it's... So what I like is to try to have collaboration with very good people from the areas where I'm not a specialist, and to try to merge the information we get from different areas. So I don't pretend to mimic exactly a human cell or a bacteria or a fungus. What I want is to give my contribution to the factorial analysis of various things that are important, and hope that upon discussion that will be used by people in studying with my more complex biological systems to increase and to enhance their knowledge and effectivity of whatever they are proposing. So I don't know if I will answer.
Yes. I fully agree with you. I think that model systems are very good approach to obtain facts and trends, and this is more easier than use complex membranes, exactly. Because we have more other types of interactions that can also affect, but at least the major trends you can obtain. I fully agree with you, and I think that is a very good approach.
Okay. Yeah, that's what I've been trying. So I'm sorry, just I think maybe there is no other people willing to ask, or Pedro will, but what I was just going to say, I know that I was spanning a lot in a short time, but my idea was to give you an overview. And then I put the references there. If you want to see more detail, you can go. Pedro, please.
Well, first of all, I apologize, João. Professor, I have a very simple question. It is somehow related to some work that I'm carrying out now. It is related to the first part, when you use its lactoferrin peptides, we see that the protein has some antimicrobial logical activity. Then when we go down in size, it seems that the activity increases. So we might think that the size will be a relevant parameter, but then when we go from the simple peptides to the chimera, the size increases and is more effective. So perhaps it's more a charge, as you mentioned. I believe these works are undertaken at physiological pH, Mm-hmm. Is that correct? So
yes,
the groups that we are talking about are the amino and guanidine from lysine and arginine.
Yeah.
Is that correct? The positively charged. Mm-hmm. So my question is this one. Do you have the proportion from lysines to arginines in these peptides to see if they have some influence on the work?
In fact, these peptides have lysines and they have no arginines because
the last one didn't have. I could see the sequence, but the first I couldn't see that.
Because the classically, your question is very interesting because classically the antimicrobial peptides used were only had the lysines.
Mm-hmm.
Because arginines were considered cell-penetrating peptides and not antimicrobial peptides.
Mm-hmm.
At the very beginning, is like 12 years ago. And so there were two different areas. Cell-penetrating peptides were peptides that were able to cross the membranes without destructing it, and they were rich in arginine.
Mm-hmm.
And the antimicrobial peptides were destructing the membrane, and they were rich in lysines, or only in many cases, only the ones that were built by us only had lysines. And then the group, in fact, of a Swedish researcher in Stockholm, that she was a specialist in antimicrobial peptides, in cell penetrating, she wrote a very nice paper a couple of years ago showing that, in fact, antimicrobial peptides can have arginines and cell penetrating peptides can have lysines. At this moment, in these new cyclic peptides that I am studying with my new PhD student, we are trying to see the effect of interchanging lysines and arginines. But I don't have yet an answer for you because this is ongoing work. So we started with some peptides that had a mixture, then we did some with only lysines and some with only arginines because my impression, but you should not take it this is impression, is that arginine, I don't know if I should say, because I'm not sure if this is correct. I think lysines are very important for the electrostatic interaction and arginines are more important for the entrance. But that's what I can say up to now, because that's what we are trying to evaluate now. Because before this was considered two different areas. And so in the peptides I worked until now, they had only lysines, not arginines. Now I'm working with both.
Okay, thank you very much.
So I think that's all. So for my side, I thank you very much for being here with me. And Pedro for having invited, and Pedro and João and all of you for the questions and the appearance. I mean, it was a pleasure. I always like to talk with people about my work. And so see you one of these days.
Thank you very much, Professor.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you so much, Professor.